This is the engraving tool project for tool design. What I'm expecting to get out of this assignment is a few things. First of all, there is sort of these nuts and bolts of being able to make tooling. But what's really going on behind all of that is the trying to get you to think like a designer who's designing objects to be made. All right, so kind of think like a tool maker. And, you know, we're trying to hit another level of precision with this project than we have in some of the projects in the past. So what we're trying to do is get you to machine some tool steel, get you some experience with that, get you a little bit of experience heat treating, running a surface grinder, understanding surface finish a little bit, using cutting tools like a reamer, also designing cutting tools and understanding a little bit more about cutting tool geometry. A chance for you to apply some limits and fits. You may have already done a little bit of that in Tech 4472, and we'll do it later in this semester, and I'll try to link out to our lecture on limits and fits that's coming up, but this will get you some, you'll be able to use them first of all, and then maybe we'll just learn a little more about them later. Also, there's a taper on the end of here. This 60-degree included angle is a taper. Also, we'll see a little bit more about using the universal cutter grinder, and let you practice doing some press fitting as well as designing press fits. All right, so this tool has got three parts, and if you hold it in your hand, you'll see that this tool steel part comes out, and the rest of this will look like a single part. Okay, so even though it has this plug that is press fit inside here, what you do is you press fit that plug in, and then you'll machine face off the end of this. And if you've done the press fit right and the machining and everything else right, then this will look like a solid piece of aluminum. What I want you to see from this diagram is, first of all, the function of this plug in here is to stop the actual cutter a certain distance into the holder, and it also prevents rotation. Okay, so this allows the cutter to slide in. And then what you can do is reverse the cutter and put it in so the pointy end goes up into this recess here, and the back end is not flat, but it's not pointy like that. It's a little less dangerous. I will say, don't take... TSA has confiscated several of these from former students, so don't try to take it on an airplane for whatever that's worth. All right, but anyway, what we have here is three different shafts fitting into a hole. Okay, and what I want you to kind of understand is that there's not just one design for a shaft fitting into a hole. These have three separate purposes. This one needs to fit nice and precisely. In fact, if you do this properly, then the amount of clearance around this thing is just barely big enough for air to come in and out, and it'll make a really nice pop sound when you pull it out. So this is a nice precision running fit inside here. At the back end here, this is a force fit, so this is a press fit where the diameter of this plug is actually larger than the hole that it's going into. And then this last part here is a loose running fit. Okay, so this half sort of semi-cylindrical shape fits very easily. We don't want to have any kind of this should go in without touching the walls of the inside of the hole at all. All right, now, in terms of guidance, really expect a lot less guidance in this project than you would have gotten, say, in Tech 1711, where I tell you step-by-step how to build that hammer, okay? There is some guidance that we'll have down in the shop mainly because of some of the tooling that we have set up to make this nice and consistent, but I want you to think about the parts as you're making them and think about what cuts need to be made first, and then come up with a sequence of machining operations. All right, but this print is basically all done for you. There's nothing left for you to design on this particular print. Now there are some things to watch out for. In particular, there is this cut that happens right here. So, let's just draw this thing in the uncut configuration. This is the center line of the part. Okay, so down the middle of the part, the point of this would align perfectly with the center line. Now, you're not just going to grind out all of this material. What we want to grind out, we want to minimize the amount of grinding that happens. So after we've heat treated, we want to grind away this portion right here. Okay, before we heat treat though, we want to mill out this section. Okay, so we're going to mill out this area on the cutter right here. Now, if you mill all the way down to the center line, there won't be any material left to grind. Okay, and that's why we want to leave behind some material inside here to grind. Now, 30 thou is a little bit much. 20 thou is about perfect. So if you can leave 20 thou when you get done milling, so set up to mill down not to the center line, mill down to about 20 thou above the center line. Okay, so there's no min on this, but really it probably should be 20 thou plus or minus 10 for this dimension right here. But this is a real common thing to mess up. If you actually machine down to the point, then you've messed up. So you need to leave this material behind. Now on the back side, there is this step back here. Okay. Now if this step is too tall, this is what locks in with the plug and prevents the actual cutter from rotating inside the holder. So this tolerance, okay, I'm trying to really point it out. If this is not within tolerance, then this thing will not nest properly within the plug. You'll also notice some pretty tight tolerances here. So for the diameter of this part, for this thing to be a precision running fit, the particular precision running fit that I'm going to ask for, those are your tolerances. Okay, now turns out those are actually pretty easy to hit because we're going to use some drill rod, some precision round ground drill rod to manufacture this part out of, and that will get us right into this ballpark to begin with. So that's it's not quite cheating, but I'm just showing it's possible to get some really nice tolerances without too much effort sometime. All right, so now on the holder, you will see that this part has been has been redacted a little bit. Okay, so there's this number is for you to find. In fact, it's not just a number, it's a set of limits. Okay, and those limits are based on the fact that we have a 0.501 diameter hole. So we're starting with a 0.501 basic diameter hole, and our tolerances are coming from the fact that marketing or whoever it is asking for an RC3 precision running fit. So those two bits of information are going to be enough for you to figure out what the hole tolerances should be on this hole through here. And I will tell you again, a nice easy way to hit this tolerance is to use the 0.501 oversized reamer that we have in the lab. So you'll be able to design this that will allow you to produce a hole that's going to fall within these limits most likely. All right, but that information is not given to you. You're going to have to sort that information out, those details. And let me just say, you need to come to lab knowing what those dimensions are. Now, for the plug, you'll notice there are even fewer dimensions given, so there's more design work for you to do. So I want you to actually, I think the easiest way to do this is to go into your CAD software, whatever it is. It can be anything at this point. You can use Inventor. Well, I'm not going to name them. You use whatever you want to. CAD-wise, but you want to draw this up so that when the cutter is turned around and put in here, that there's room for the pointy end to go in here. On the back side, you want this end to line up with the end of the hole. All right, so this thing needs to be able to reverse. So it needs to be aim for this to be nice and flush when it's in the assembled position, in the working position, and try to do it so that this winds up being flush when it's in the reversed position. So this should be lined up with this edge right here. So that's what you want, how you want this thing to function. And those design, sorting out those details, those are your job. That's up to you to figure out before you come to lab. All right, so that's what you're going to do here. You're going to figure out how to make these dimensions make the thing work the way that marketing wants it to function. And keep in mind also these diameters. So this is the loose running portion. This needs to slide right into the holder. This other part needs to be a force fit. Let me advise you to pay very careful attention to this force fit. This is a sticking point, not only from the design side, making sure that you get the numbers right for your limits, but when you machine this, you have to take these limits seriously, because if it's not machined to very carefully to fall within those FN5 limits, then it won't work. All right. If it's too big, it will not press fit. We've had students try to hang multiple people from the arbor press, which is not allowed. That's how they wound up breaking an arbor press. How you break an arbor press is beyond me. But anyway, that's not going to work. If it doesn't work, it doesn't work. Also, if it's too small, it'll slide right in, or the part will twist as you're trying to use it. So pay careful attention to these FN5 limits. Also, this really should be like the first slide. You need to be precise for this to work. You cannot just go in there and try to cut willy-nilly and make this thing work. So you need to go in with dimensions that are going to work, and you need to hit those dimensions for this thing to function. I have kind of suggested some manufacturing steps for you. Don't really expect a whole lot more guidance from me on this. I'll give you a little guidance on the heat treatment when it comes time to do that. I will say, notice this color. All right, so when you temper, this is kind of the color that we're shooting for, kind of a light straw, almost the color of this plywood behind the part here. And we do have, I'm trying to get some better temperature controls, but the temperature is pretty well controlled on our tempering / toaster oven. But anyway, this is a suggested manufacturing sequence. One thing is that the actual working surfaces need to happen after the part has been heat treated. So you'll machine the rough shape, you'll heat treat, and then you will grind on the rake face and the reliefs. Again, suggested steps for manufacturing the holder. I'm not going to tell you how to do this. Okay, you're going to be given a 12-foot long stick of aluminum, and you're supposed to figure out how to cut this thing in the proper sequence so that you don't do silly things like clamping on these knurls, that sort of thing. Also, if you're going to machine knurls off, machine them all the way off. So hopefully you'll have a better looking cutter than this. All right, so this is what's going to happen after you do the heat treating. You'll grind on this rake face, and this is where you're going to remove that last 20 thou or so. This is the milled surface, so you milled it down to this level, and then you'll grind it down to this level, which should be about 20 thou. That's a good easy to hit number that will give you good results. Now I will say, be sure and get with me when you get ready to use this fixture. Okay, this is a real dangerous kind of setup if things are not done properly. You can wind up pulling this fixture into the grinding wheel, which is absolutely not what we want. Also, there's some things on here that you should notice. This fixture is designed to hold the cutter, but it also has this spot on here. We'll talk about this in fixture design, but this height has been precision ground into the fixture so that it is at the proper level. That'll be on center line with this, and that'll give us a nice neutral rake angle on this cutter. All right, and then in addition to that rake face that you're going to grind on, you're going to grind two separate surfaces on here, the two reliefs, and it's really, we'll talk about this later, but it's the reliefs on here, the clearances, that actually turn this thing into a cutter. All right, so it'll kind of cut without these, but it turns into a real cutter when you grind these on. All right, so this is the primary relief, and what you want to do, I'll show you how to set this machine up, and you'll grind this face off. Until this line disappears, and it should just intersect with the rake face. That's your primary relief. And then you're going to grind this conical relief on after you have ground that primary relief in. So this is the one that gives you clearance as the tool continues to rotate. And this is offset by 10 thou. So that's why we have this spacer in here to shove the cutter away from the cutting edge more and more as it shifts the center line of rotation of this cone off by 10 thou from the center line of the actual cutter. So try to think about that a little bit and understand what's going on there. What that means is as this thing turns, it gets farther and farther away. The clearance provides more and more space away from where the cut actually happened. All right, and then finally, if you're in Tech 4476, you can actually chuck up this engraver and use it to engrave into the end of the holder. You can put your initials or a symbol or whatever you want to on the back side of this thing. So back on this side over here where you've machined it nice and flush. All right, but that's the introduction, and please come to lab prepared. with those numbers in hand. So show up to lab with the redacted prints there on the e-courseware. The actual prints are on here. Okay, so the redacted holder, the plug print is on here. So get those and design these numbers. Design this plug so that it functions. Well, the plug and all the rest. So all these redacted drawings mean you have some work to do. Go ahead and bring this cutter drawing into class as well. And in terms of the sequence, we'll just work out the sequence as best we can in class. These are some documents that you're going to need. So for instance, this is the RC3 fits out of the machinery's handbook. Okay, so the information you need should be in there. There is a link later in the semester out. Let me just find it. We have a limits and fits lecture that is coming up. Okay, so you can drop down, watch that limits and fits lecture, a little bit out of sequence. Don't have to take a test on it. Go ahead and just take it, understand it, and then we will, later on, you'll actually understand it well enough to take a quiz or a test. But I think it'll help if you've actually made these before. All right, so that is your introduction to the engraving project. Engraving.